There are different reasons for this. One reason is that we sometime in the future want to be able to support offline maps, or offline mode maps. And then just downloading information and rendering it, compared to downloading images, takes up a lot of less space on your hard drive. So to make an offline mode feasible, you would like to render on the client side. Another way to look at it is that we want to have really, really nice maps, really nice gnomes maps, and then we can use this local client-side rendering to create our own style and create beautiful maps. And also, if we're moving forward, I want to rely less on third-party services for gnome maps. I want to rely less on map servers from OpenStreetMaps or from MapQuest or from wherever, because we're not a web app, we're a desktop application. And if one of these services says you can't use our data anymore, and one of these services cease to exist, then all versions of the maps will be broken. So right now, the maps uses OpenStreetMaps to get its map data. And OpenStreetMaps is a collaborative project. The goal is to create an editable map of the world. It's sort of like a Wikipedia of maps. Built by volunteers, a lot of them. 20,000 changes per day to the maps. I think the timeline is someone edits the map, and 1 to 2 days later, we will have it in no maps. Something like that. The way this is done, by mapping in OpenStreetMap, is you can create three types of objects. You can create a node, which is just to say, this is a place. A node does not have a geometrical. It's only a dot, it's not a polygon, it's not a line scheme, it's just a place. You can say, here's a pub, here's a park, here's something. That's a node. And then you have a way, which is either a line stream or an area or a polygon. So it's a geometric area, a way. And then you have a relation, which is a way to group different objects together. So you have this highway, this highway, this highway, and this pathway. Together they make a route, and that's a relation. Or you have this building, this building, this building. Together they make a campus. Something like that. And then you have something called tags. This is just key value tags used in OpenStreetMap. So you can say something like, this is a highway and it's pedestrian. This is a highway, it's a motorway. Or this is a building, it's a pub. Something like this. And there's no rules to this, no hierarchy. So it's totally freestyle how you enter these tags when you're mapping something. So it's kind of community-based in OpenStreetMaps how to tag and how to map something. If you go into the OpenStreetMap wiki, it will be page after pages. You should tag this feature as this, you should tag these features as that. So it's non-hierarchical and very freestyle. And then we have all map clients that you know and love today use map tiles as a way to break up the world. And the way it works, you have a tile. It's most often 256 pixels squared. And you have zoom levels. On each zoom level, the tile contains more or less detail. You reference a tile by X, Y, and Z, where Z is zoom level. And there's zoom levels between 0 and 20. The reason you split up the map in tiles is to make caching easier, also to implement progressive loading, so you can load parts of the map synchronous. And these zoom levels, they include 4 to the power of zoom level tiles. If you're having trouble visualizing this, I'll try to help you. So in the far left, you have all the tiles in zoom level 0. Then you have all the tiles in zoom level 1. Then all the tiles in zoom level 2. And then you can just imagine this continuing zoom level by zoom level. It really escalates quickly. So you see down at zoom level 18, you have this number of tiles. This is not as crazy as it sounds, because most tiles are never used. Most tiles are never viewed. So most tile servers create and cache tiles on demand, on the fly. And the number of actual viewed tiles by users are much, much less than these astronomical figures. In maps, we use zoom level 2 to 17, so we don't go to 18, 19, 20. That's partially because there's no whole world support for the really, really high zoom levels. Okay, so one alternative to using bitmap tiles or image tiles is vector tiles. Vector tiles are tiles in the same manner as image tiles, that they split up the world in the same manner, they have the same coordinate system. But instead of having pre-rendered map data in the tiles, you have a vector representation of the features. So you have metadata, you'll have the tags from OpenStreetMap, and you'll have the geometric representation of the area. And they're most often smaller than the image tiles. I did some experiments. I downloaded Gothenburg, zoom level 14, 15, 16, and 17, both as OpenStreetMap PNGs and Mapbox vector tiles. And you can see for zoom level 14, the image is actually smaller than the vector. At least uncompressed. But as you get more and more details, the vector tile starts to win. And the real win is when you compress them. Because when you compress a PNG, it's not that much of a gain. But if you compress this kind of vector tiles, you'll get a really, really large win. You can see Gothenburg image tiles, 67 megabytes, and vector tiles, 13 megabytes. So it's quite some win. This Mapbox vector tile format. Mapbox is a company that works a lot with maps. A lot of map geeks working there. And it's one part commercial, but has licenses that are favorable for non-commercial use. And they release a lot of open source software as well, so it's nice to our community. And the Mapbox vector tile format is a Google protocol buffer space. And it consists of layers. Say you have all your water, all your land use, all your roads, all your buildings, split up by layers. And then each layer contains features, and each feature contains geometry. So sort of like, you have your tags and your metadata, your key value. It tells you this feature is a point, a line stream, or polygon. And it contains encoded geometry. And the geometry is encoded in a smartish way, using some zigzag encoding. But the real, it maps to move to like to a closed path, which people using Python get so familiar with the commands. So it's not that hard to do. Get this, it's totally on style. You just have like, this is an area, this is a line, this is something. In order to make it pretty, we need some way to say how should I draw this. And then there's a couple of different standards. I think the two most prominent are MapCSS and CartoCSS. I focused on MapCSS here, and the only reason is because I didn't feel confident in parsing CartoCSS, because I'm not a parser guy. So, but the basic principle is the same. MapCSS is very similar to ordinary CSS, but instead of selecting different HTML stuff, you select on OpenStreetMap tags. So for instance, you can say, for these highways, I want a line with this width, this color, and the segment is like which layer, which drawing order. Selectors are the object types I talked about earlier, the way information, and also some special cases of them, like an area is a way that's enclosed, a line is some way that's not enclosed, the canvas is like the map background, and the star is wildcard match, I think. And you can also have these kind of tests, like for all ways that has the tag is tunnel, yes, to do something. For all ways in the zoom levels 8 to 17 that matches these tags, do something. So you have different tests and different zoom level filters. And there's also some support for evaluation functions, like make the width of this highway twice the amount of pixels, but there are lanes you can make expressions depending on different tags. So yeah, so what I did when I had some time in my life, I sat down and I wrote a library called VectorTileGlib that parsed these Mapbox VectorTile format and parsed the MapCSS and tried to make something with it using Cairo. So it's using glib and the object, plays nice with bindings. It renders Mapbox VectorTile, and I support a subset of MapCSS. Yeah, I currently use Flex and Lemon as a tokenizing the parser. This is totally open for change. But what I needed to do to get something working. I also wrote libshotline, is the map widget we use in maps. It's based on having map sources and map renderers. So what I did, I wrote a libshotline renderer in order to hook into maps. It's all posted on GitHub, so pull request welcome. This is how it looked when I wrote my first map CSS file, the left image, and used it in maps. And this is how it looked after Andreas started helping me. So, we need help. And I'm going to be foolish and try a live demo as well. We want to see ways. That's what Sidan show. Yeah, so these are the residential hierarchies in Gothenburg. We can say thank you. there's a lot of work to be done for this, but we have some. So, I have a wish list for this. I know I might be unreasonable, but I really would like tiles.gnome.org. This might cost a lot of money, I'm not sure. I haven't done the calculations of what machines are needed. Basically, what we would need to do is periodically download the world and adopt it myself. It's like 4 gigabytes. And over a period of time, create vector tiles for these. Either create them on the go or create some kind of static files for them. The reason I want this is because I want to be able to be confident that some service will not terminate and in-apps stranded. And also I want to be able to do APIs like download this area and not have to do like 1,000 HTTP requests to download tiles. Of course, improve vector tile GLib, I'm not sure. That might be the path. Maybe make that library really good. Solve issues like stitching vector together and placing labels. These are hard issues. Maybe we want to go the route of trying to port some existing library. There are Mapbox GL, sort of a C++ program that at the moment does not compile on Fedora. I don't know enough C++ to see why, or I don't know if you can make it into a library, if you can make it into a GLib library. If someone wants to give that a go, that would be great. Keep beautifying the style, of course. And then there's adding of offline support to libchamplan and maps. This does not need vector tiles. I mean, Gothenburg was 60, 70 megabytes using image tiles. That might be reasonable for some people. So that can be forked off from the vector tile client side only. We made a product of its own. And I don't think it's hard. So if anyone feels like, I want to do that, come talk to me and I can do this and this. And something we can also get from this is some kind of offline search, because these tiles contain tags and we can get the information of where they are. So we could have a rudimentary search engine searching through the vector tiles. And we can also pick out like points of interest and stuff like that from the vector tiles. So, what Maps needs are people willing to do this. We have a bunch of ideas, and we know kind of how we want to do them, but we don't have anyone at the moment with time to implement them. This is not something that will be in 3.18. It might be in 3.20 if we get people willing to work on this. And we have people willing to mentor. We have GNOME Lab bugs in Maps to have easy access to the code base. So if anyone feels like I want to work on Maps, do all this kind of cool stuff, come talk to me. Yes, questions. Thank you very much. So the memory consumption of Maps and libchamplan when you run, I'm not sure. I haven't measured it. There's some cache going on, memory cache that has some kind of limit in libchamplan, how many files do I have, and where you can throw some away. So I don't know, but if it's unreasonable, we can fix it. That's the question, but I think that's it. Maps by itself are not that large. Tile is like 9. Kilobytes of data if it's a large tile, and you have maybe at the maximum 20 tiles visible. I mean, it's, if you manage this well, the memory consumption needs not to be that much.
Okay, thank you. how do you currently make those styles? Is it manual, or like you download it from somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. You're talking about the vector tiles.
Yeah, like where you get them from, and why would we need a separate server instead of getting them from wherever you're getting them right now?
Right now, I'm using MapCSS, which is another map company, which provides a data source service where I download these vector tiles. I have not read their terms of service yet, so I don't know if we could use any maps. Maybe we could. That would be awesome. We could talk to them, maybe set up some kind of proxy and have some kind of relationship.
Well, what's the name again?
MapCSS.
Thank you.
So one problem with if we want to do offline support, just rendering the tiles is probably also a good thing. There are tons of services or something like that. But on the other hand, if you want to download, say, I'm doing like 1,000 HTTP requests, that's probably not possible. So that's one reason why you might want to have a separate server. Work is kind of on the infrastructure side, you know, how do we get to obtain my data and render it and consume it. Have you thought about ways people will want to use the maps on their computers? I use maps a lot on my phone, but when I use them on my phone, it's completely different from how I use them on my computer. Like on the phone, I'm either out in the street looking for an address and use a map. Or if I find a cool place, I will set a point on my map on my phone, like home, I will actually add it to OpenStreetMap myself. Or sometimes I will record a GPS route and then use that to trace a map or something. And then when I'm at home, I'm either looking for interesting places to visit or just editing the map. So, like, the uses are pretty different. Have you thought about what people might want to use in GNOME?
Yes, it is tricky. My position is that the GNOME Maps application will stay a basic map application, simple map application, and that it takes search, route, favoriting. And then I know people want to do a lot of things with the map, like render nice maps of printing, or do this, or do that. We will get the best ideas. I think the best way is to make special apps for that. We contribute a lot to libshutdown, which is the map region. So the development on GNOME will help anyone, the GNOME apps, that anyone wants to make like specialized application. And we could, we already have a private search library. We can also need like maps functionality library for other applications. But at the moment, no maps does not have the bandwidth at all to be anything else than a simple map application. I would love to talk to anybody who wants to make a specialized application, how to move forward, which technologies to use. But yes, we have thought about it, but it's tricky.
So you're getting these, you've talked about having the tile servers. So how is it constructed, these vector tiles? Like is it getting some data from an OpenStreetMap and then it creates vector tiles from that data? So.
Yeah, pretty much what it is. You have this planet.osm file, which is the whole world in vector data from that OpenStreetMap provides. You can download it. And then the process that MapCSS does is they go through this and they create vectors from it. So they chop up the larger vectors and construct tiles. And well, I think that what they do this on the fly. So you say, I want this tile. And giving the X, Y, Z of the tile, you will have this area and they will construct a vector tile from it. And the details in the tile will be determined by the zoom level. So it's OpenStreetMap data, it's just chopped up on a larger vector. did some work when we tried to go like a separate server for search, like, and that turned out to be a monster machine. I think the machine we need to generate types does not need to be as monstrous as the one we need to generate a search space or a route space. But I have not done the specs. I would love to someone, if someone wanted to help out with that as well. Maybe we could do like a crowdfunding thing together, types.num.org. I don't know. Maybe we could use MapCSS. The problem is, these are assignments for known volunteers as well. We need people for development, and we also need people like, can we do this? Can we do that? What kind of infrastructure is needed? Like, my project manager or someone who wants to work on infrastructure for maps or something like that. Because these are important questions if you want to do this. So unfortunately, no.
This is all great, by the way. What do you think the chances are that next year for Guadic we could have a city pack wherever the Guadic is that includes all of the local events and all of that that we could just download and put right into maps?
Very high. Before this talk I hacked together a local file source that used the data I downloaded. Now, because of the data I displayed it, that was using all that the infrastructure already in Chaplin and maps, and half an hour back, so making maps open like a bundle or a path to already download sources we can have ready for 318 if we want to, if we have people. That is not hard. So we could definitely have it for next one.
That'd be great, I'd love that.
So I have a question regarding the display, which is both in terms of how nice it can, I mean, how easy it is to hack the CSS and make it to your liking. And there's two parts to it. One of them, it would be nice if there could be a CSS per theme. So if I prefer a dark theme to GNOME, boom, I'd get a slightly darker map style or, you know, that kind of stuff. But more importantly, for people who are colorblind or who have got they've got sensitive eyes, it'd be great if we could actually include ship with it. Those, if I activate the options in accessibility setting, I'm colorblind or like low contrast or high contrast, that automatically that style sheet gets applied to maps. That would be a killer feature. I don't think any other operating system does that, or any other system does that. Have you considered that?
Thank you. No, but it's a great idea. I mean, we could tie into it if you don't know that's accessibility, that tells you that you have a problem seeing or something, we could definitely choose a theme with more contrast or the high contrast theme. Absolutely. It comes down to resources, I guess. We need people doing this CSS. The first part of the question, how hard is this? I mean, the CSS part is not that hard. But then you have to go like find out what are all these tags. I talked about in the beginning, there's no structured way for tagging. It's like a community decided way how tags are done. So you should have to like spend some time familiarizing with OpenStreetMap and tagging. You have to sort of become part of that community. So it's both. It's not hard, but it can be time consuming, I guess. Maybe Andreas, who has done more CSS map starting than me, can answer.
As you were saying, I mean, a lot of it comes down to like, okay, I'm basing my styling around Gutenberg, and like always you have like. But yeah, they're very free form, like all the tags. Like you could have a tag for fish factory, which only exists in Gutenberg. So you'll have to start with building, but there is possibly a specific fish factory thing that only exists in one country, in one city, in one part of the world. So, but then again, like a lot of it is fairly general. So like the pathways and the buildings and things like that. And I think definitely the high contrast thing is an idea. I will certainly, first and foremost, focus my efforts on the regular one, but the accessibility one, which I think is a really interesting and cool idea. And whoever is interested in hacking that, come ask me how you do it, or like how to get started. It's fairly straightforward, I would say.
Yeah. And I mean, if we move to some format like call to CSS or pre-processed CSS, where you can like define variables for colors, we could have like, here's the style, and here's the color scene. Spin up.
Hi. This is, you know, Edward's idea is a great idea, and I think that might be also a good way to get funding for starting the maps, and maybe enable us to also pay for the server and whatever bandwidth would be necessary to run the services. So I think that if you get a better idea of what would be needed in terms of time, in terms of help, maybe this is something that we can run through one of our outreach programs, for example, so that we would be able to get people interested in starting the site.
Absolutely, and there are some styles out there. It's hard to find complete styles. You can find a lot of examples or quirky styles. So I like I want a political map, so I style boundaries for countries, so I want this, so I want that. And MapCSS is used for some of these pre-rendered types as well. So there are styles out there, and there are people who love them. In order to like take one of those styles and use it for no maps, we really need to be more feature complete in the vector type library or use a different library. But sure, and we already, Marcus, contributor to new maps, is also part of like the OpenStreet community. So it's like a bridge there, and he knows a lot more about all these tags and stuff like that. So.
I would say one problem with the existing styles out there is also that they tend to push in a lot of details, even on a very high zoom level, so like the default of a street map, they really push information in there, so it's like completely impossible to read it. And I think that's fine for their main map, their use case. Like you get this idea that it's like this map with so much interesting and cool information, and you can just add more to it. So I think that was definitely a goal of this style as well, to keep the like finer details to the closest level, for example.
Yeah, absolutely. You have a point, because OpenStreetMap, like, it's fun. I went to my local park and I added like the adventure golf things, and I waited, and 2 days later I saw it on the map. I mean, that's what we were after with OpenStreetMap. I added something, now I see it, so everything is included.
You know how in OpenStreetMap.org you go there to a map and you can select like the default map or the cycling map and the transport map. Those are pretty useful. If we end up supporting different map styles in Gnome maps, it would definitely be useful to ship different styles that you find useful. If you're traveling, like you want the metro map for a town, so you want a transport map or a cycling map or something. And I've been doing a cycling map of my area at home. There's lots of poor roads and stuff. And I've definitely found, like you mentioned, like a difference in levels. You want different amounts of detail, like on a very, very high level, you want like the roads, or on a smaller level, you want landmarks, a few interesting buildings, so that you can write yourself in the ground. So yeah, it would be useful.
We use the photo one, or a satellite photo, and good paths that are there right now, but I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, if you go into our webpage for no maps, you can see mockups of sort of this. You have, like you saw, I choose the layer. You have the street map and the area. In the mockups, there's also a orthogonal menu for like layers. So that it's again down to developer bandwidth. There are services, there are APIs, there are ways to do this. It's all about getting people who want to hack on maps.
Yeah, so basically the idea is to have aerial map and a base map that is really uncluttered, and then use services to overlay like cycle paths and stuff like that that can trigger. So, yeah, I mean, for whatever reason, if you want cycle maps together with traffic congestion, you could add both of those services. But it's like something that we have thought about over here at some point, written down, and then I don't know, we need someone to do it or look into what services are available. So, and also like what terms of service they have, and it's also a problem like international. Like we already depend on like at least three different external services for routing, the files, and the search. And if we add even more, at some point maps will become fragile because some of these services will shut down and we'll be like, yeah, we'll have to wait 6 months for the next release to be released. So actually, yeah, put it off, obviously help us there as well, but yeah, so.
Basically working on a radio application that is supposed to make a map with like a rectangle and a city name. So when you search for a city name, it will display the map with like a callback. So when you click on the map, you can call a function so that you can start the playback of audio for that location. Is that possible with the current GeoBit?
Exactly, that code is in context right now. So if you go to non context code base and look at the something widget, like the displays a contact, what I did there was use LibShipLang to show a map of the address of the contact. And if you click it, you go to maps.
Okay.
So it has all the components you need.
Excellent.
So in this kind of multi-app producer of data, do we have a desktop service that caches tiles locally? So we can share download space and download times and all that.
Yes, or maybe. We have LibShipLang caches in your .cache directory, in your own directory.
And then share it between apps.
Yeah,
okay.
So yeah. And also, your searches, right, Zishan, are cached. So when you use them in nothing, or uclue, or library, no, ucode, or library ucode, and you use it from context, and you use it from maps, it will be cached. It will not go out on the network if the search was in your cache. You just get the results back. So we have caching of search results, and we have caching of types, yes. And you will notice. notice that very, very quickly, especially if you use maps here or bad network. If you go somewhere like the first time, you can do it, so next time.